Request all the participants kindly mute your mic and the video. Only two participants they have unmute their mic and video. Please kindly cooperate. Bandra Chella, kindly see that. Unmute mic if anybody speaking kindly, please.
Dr. Dominic sir, please unmute your mic and speak.
Yeah, okay. Can you start now, sir? Hello?
Sir, yes, sir, please, sir, yes.
Yeah. So today's current scenario, the present topic for me is expected of library users. So if you take academic institutions, the library users are UG students, PG students, and research scholars, and the faculty members. So these are all mostly the users of library. So what do they expect from the library in the present scenario? Because since the institution is all closed, and still the academic institution has not yet started, some institution have started theory classes, theory only through the online. So that is the current situation that it is happening. To say a few things about my own experience in the past, how do they expect? So we can make a two categories in this. One is undergraduate degree students, they are separate. And another one is PG research students and another faculty is different. So if you take UG students, they used to come to library. So the resources that what we have, even in online, like e-journal, e-books, and whatever that we subscribe. So even if we give that, their expectation is different because they are not using that online resources. They expect the library printed books only. So that was the experience that we faced in our institution. Whereas the PG and research scholars, they are highly using the online resources. Almost all research scholars, they want to access online journals and also books and other research materials and reports, etc. So on. So this is the two types of categories of users that we have in our library. I think most of the library is the same thing. It is happening. So even if we give we say that an online journals and books are available, so the undergraduate students are not preferred to go through the online books, maybe some exceptional cases. When we take a report, statistical report of usage of library, as well as the online resources, how much they have used in one semester, this was the report that we got it in our institution, that undergraduate students are less used the digital resources, whereas the PG and PhD students are highly used these online resources. So that type of current scenario is there. But now it is lockdown, they may be expecting more resources through online. I think so. So the other thing is, the whatever the when we take the resources, that is also changing now. Almost all resources have been
sir, can digital. You please unmute your video?
Now it is born digital, it started coming.
Please kindly unmute your video and talk, sir. Coming, sir. Because not clear, let us see.
Sorry, sir.
Or you can talk loudly, little loud.
Yes, sir. Now can you hear, sir?
Yes, sir.
And when we take up the resources, now we can. So the resources, now we can see that almost all resources started coming in a digital form, as well as parallelly the printed form. And also the institutions, we have started using the digital repositories in the form of digital. Even in our institution, almost all digital resources like content proceedings and all the other reports and even the question papers, now we are uploading only in a soft copy. So like that, the digital resources one side started coming, and another side, we are trying to develop a mobile app where to reach the users. So that is another one where the users are expecting one click. They want to click and they want to get the resources. Even more than the website, now they are expecting the mobile app when they click it and they can search it and then they can download. So that type of technologies they are expecting now by the users. And another one is remote access. But remote access, I could say that we cannot give it remote access openly to everybody, because we should have through our users only we have to give the remote access, because when we give it, what happens openly, there is a misuse happening, lot of n number of downloads happening by some other people. So that happens in the remote access. I think the other speaker will be talking about more on remote access. And another thing is that which we made last semester, last academic year, is the syllabus textbooks. So that is textbooks as well as the reference book. So now the digital copy of the textbook is available by different publishers. What we did is we have collected the entire syllabus. We have categorized according to the publishers. And as a first step, we got around 250 books from the Pearson Book Publishing. And we have uploaded it in our server also. And even that also, it is not used by the much used by the undergraduate students. PG syllabus has been used much by the PG students. And this syllabus, we have given link with the website of our main website, university website. Wherever there is a textbook and reference book which has been prescribed, that we have given for easy access, then they can the syllabus or read the syllabus. From there itself, they can access the textbook. So that facility is also we have created, because this is what I am telling is the users expect information very quickly, because now they are not preferred to sit and scan, and they are not preferred to spend time on this type of thing. Then in one click they want, or immediately they want, that is the current scenario by the users. Even their attitude is like that only. Immediately they want, they need the information. Another one is most of the users expect, apart from the classroom teaching syllabus, it is the competitive exam, career guidance, because these two are not given by the classroom teaching by the faculty. So they expect the books on this areas. It is the duty of the librarian to develop the collection in this area every year with the current books. Then only we can be able to serve the users with the current information on the career guide. Because in the classroom, they do not get any such type of information. So that we have to do it. And next thing, when we talk about when we see the digital resources, there is another effort by the government, that is National Digital Library, n number of open sources that is available. So we should try to teach them how to use this digital National Digital Library resources, because many universities are just uploading the publications in the National Digital Library. So that is one resource where we can train the students, asking them how to use it, and we can guide them to these resources. In our university, what we do is, we are subscribing many resources on e-journals as well as the e-books. So every year I used to call the publishers directly and ask them to give the orientation, because every time the portal is getting updated, and they will know much about that publishing portal. So I used to call almost all 6 or 7 publishers directly every year, and we give orientation, we teach the students. In that case also, PG and PhD students, they do attend, but undergraduate students, they do not attend these sessions. And another thing is that we have a problem with the digital space, because everything we cannot, because every portal, when we start subscribing, the portal is increasing. 7, 8, 9 each resources, they are different, different portal. Either we are giving just a link, each user has to go each link to access the resources, or we have to develop or create another search like federated search or like intelligent search to access in one gateway. So that becomes a problem. In order to avoid that, what we did is we download all ebooks that what we subscribe and we upload it in our server for a quick and easy access. In that case also, we are started facing the space, digital space. So that becomes another problem for the librarian to face the digital space. And we are going another server like that, keep on server. Till now we have made it 2 server. We don't know the future. So that is the current scenario that it is happening in a university library, private university library. So I think most of the colleges and universities are facing the same thing. And also the user's attitude has becoming like this. They need a, undergraduates are different, and PG and UT, PG and research scholars, they both are different. So they want information only through online, and these undergraduates, they want only textbook to read. Physically, they want to use the library. So that is the current scenario that it is happening, and we have to think of how we can start it.
Time.
So thank you very much, sir. That's all I want to say.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Domini, talking about the user's expectation. Now I call Dr. Shiv, talk about the LIS education research.
Am I audible, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, great.
Sir, because all of you kindly mute your video, and only the speaker can make it, because the network is slow, I think. Please.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Very good evening to one and all present here virtually. First of all, I am sorry to say that, you know, due to some technical interruptions, I could not join in time. So because I also could guess that among the speakers, I am the junior most. So starting with the junior most faculty may not be appropriate. That is why the situation has prompted me to speak after Dr. Dominic, sir. I'm very happy to be here. So my topic, the Salis has, you know, proposed to speak on Librarians Open Conclave on the impact of COVID-19 on libraries, challenges and opportunities. And the topic given to me is that, you know, LIS education research, which is very crucial. Still, as a teacher of library science, I'm supposed to address the audience about the impact of COVID-19 on LIS education and research. Well, all of us know very well that, you know, most of the student population has been impacted by COVID-19. According to UNESCO, more than 70% of the world's student population has been, you know, in learning through online. So they are not able to meet their teachers, and that is one. And second, that is on the one hand, it has impacted the users, particularly the student population. And coming to the next one, the resource availability of resources, surprisingly, this Baidu's app, you know, it is not that affordable to everyone. But considering the current crisis situation, they also have made it free. By making it free, we have got more than 200% of the users. So since it is free, it is 200% hike on the number of users enrolled. So here we have to clearly understand that when the resources are made available, there are users. So if it is commercial, then, you know, the restrictions are given to the users. Because of that, there is a low response. And coming to this remote access services, all of us, you know, considering the situation of COVID-19, so whatever the digital resources that we have, so we are trying very hard to make it available, not only in India. It is a global scenario I talk about. So now the all the digital resources, whatever is possible, is made accessible 24/7. Similarly, which has never happened before, the publishers, the commercial publishers also have come forward, considering the situation to make all their resources accessible to anybody who wants to do that only during this period. And also, keeping this scenario in mind, we people, including library science professionals, we have started, you know, conducting webinars to educate people how to make use of the available resources, free, commercial, and open. And then when the resources are made available for free to the users, the users also have been, you know, they have totally changed. So it is not only that if I belong to a college, maybe arts and science, I'll stick to only my stakeholders. It's not like that. Now, because of the availability of resources, all cross sections of the society have started learning online. So that is the changing scenario what we have today because of this COVID-19. So the impact on education, you know, we all know very well that the conventional system was very active before this COVID-19. You can say, if you look at the proportion of the teaching offline and online, offline was 90% before, and the 10% only supplementing material with the online resources and the providing links on top. And now, the situation has completely reversed. Now we know 90% online teaching and 10% is, you know, conventional. So that too with the limited number of users and students. So now, you know, there are rumors. I don't know whether it is going to come into effect or not. The promotional agencies from India and other countries also, they have started preparing guidelines for the these academic institutions to limit the number of users who come to the institution premises, you know, personally. So here what they think, you know, 1/3 of the students, even if the universities and colleges are opened, only 1/3 of the students will be allowed to sit in the classroom with social distancing, right? The permissible distance has to be maintained. So when you talk about 1/3, what will happen to the 2/3? So the 2/3, you know, have to be taught through online. So that is the crucial situation what we have, you know, this has impacted on education. And also libraries will have to, libraries and the library science departments also have to work with the limited staff, reduced staff. So these are all the problems, you know, factors that have affected the education because of this. And when we talk about the situation, forcibly and, you know, all of a sudden we all had to be prepared for making all our resources available online and also offering our classes through online mode. So there, you know, again, there is a great impact that, you know, you have been observing. So people who are talking on one topic for a college today will be talking either same topic or some other topic for some other institution tomorrow. So the people who are talking only have been talking continuously, but all others are not able to get chance. Reason is, it's only lack of familiarity with the online platforms, number one. And also this is only for the speakers. On the other hand, for the audience, so this is based on the survey which I have made in my own department. So when I started initiating this online classes for my own students to cover up the leftover portions, so the students, you know, they made a survey, they came out with a statement that, you know, only 40% of the students will be able to attend to the classes, and the remaining 60% do not have smartphones, or even if they have the smartphones, they are not acquainted with the online classes. And even if they have smartphones and network connectivity because of the remote locations. So these are all the major issues and the impact which has happened in the education. And coming to impact on research, research, you know, here definitely the productivity has increased. So because of the availability of resources, anybody, whether they have interest or not, but they would like to write papers and they have want to publish papers with a higher productivity. So that is happening. Just, you know, for instance, this was discussed before also, and I started writing a collaborative paper on COVID-19. When we collected data till 2019, it was, you know, it was below 3000 records from all databases. But, you know, after that, just, you know, as a trial, Dr. J.P. Squarrel and I, when we tried, so it is, you know, more than 2,500 records just within a period of 6 months. So from December to May. So that is the growth which has happened. It's clear evidence that, you know, research not only in this area, many every area, every domain, it is increasing. So here the challenges, you know, for LAS education and research, and particularly for the LAS schools and libraries. So ill-equipped infrastructure. So when we all of a sudden started, so this has started, you know, this is a major issue. We do not have proper infrastructure to accommodate all these devices and gadgets. And first of all, then declining strength of LAS manpower in libraries, particularly, that is another challenge. And a lack of trained personnel or the faculty to teach the new components which have to be imparted, you know, suddenly to the stakeholders. And affordability of devices for online learning, that is another issue challenge. And training also is required for resource persons, learners, audience, and also administrators. And who will give, whether it is going to be given by the librarians or the librarians' teachers. And both have to be properly trained. Unless they are trained, giving to others will be a million-dollar question. And LA schools and the libraries, you know, there is always a lack of togetherness. This I have been telling, you know, we are now, this is the right time for us to join our hands together and work for the this action taking problems. Whatever the problems that we have currently, it has to be taken into account as in the form of research, and we have to find solution, and the solution has to be implemented immediately. And also in LA's education, we are most of us conduct research without having, you know, with the lack of vision. We cannot say that without vision, with the lack of vision, what for we are offering research. So that is the thing. So coming to this, these are all the challenges that we have to face. It will take a lot of time because you have given me only 10 minutes. So in another 2 to 3 minutes, I'll just finish my talk. So these are all the challenges, but the challenges can be a golden opportunity for us. So for in general, for LAS professionals, acquiring new skills on online teaching and learning is very much important. So there are many tools available now, you know, entire world is open with the tools, devices, and also resources, whatever is available. Now the power of information, the entire world has realized. So we as intermediaries, we cannot escape from the situation. It is a golden opportunity for us to acquire new skills to meet the changing needs of the you know, the users, changing demands, you know, new users who are going to come with the change needs to the libraries. And also networking with the other professionals, now, you know, everybody is open. Now we can collaborate with others to acquire certain technical skills which are required. Particularly, we can collaborate with the departments like management to acquire some soft skills, and English to write and speak properly, and the computer science to learn this, you know, IT related technology, this knowledge. Similarly, IT and media also, media and journalism. So how to write a proper report which can be published in the media. So all those things, you know, it is the right chance. Everybody is aware of what a library is and what librarians can do to the this academic world. Similarly, imparting wide range of competences, that is as far as the LAS professionals on the whole is concerned. So coming to LAS schools and association, imparting wide range of competences with the traditional skills, whatever we have in the curriculum, that will never, that is not going to help. It will only help to know about the past, but, you know, present, the situation is totally different. To meet the future, the present has to be completely modified. So for that, school and association, they have to work very hard jointly. And reconsidering curriculum and teaching methods. Now, you know, the chalk and talk method will not work. So we have to learn how to, you know, the pedagogy has to be completely changed to provide online resources, you know, most of online resources and less of this classroom teaching. So that is going to be the situation even after reopening of the institutions. And associations can also partner with the LA schools for offering short-term courses on particularly online learning and how to manage the digital resources online and how to make it available 24/7 without any interruptions. And also that will help, you know, to offer continuing education programs to different people who can have knowledge. So based on this, you know, now, as I told you before, that the entire world is open. Now we have to think of having, you know, only one hub. One hub, you know, one hub means we should have one library and one teaching methodology and one association to render the entire world. So because entire world is open now, the entire world is connected well with different sources. So here what we can do is that this is the right time for all of us. It's a golden opportunity to join academic libraries, special, public and school. All the libraries have to join together and all cannot be equally balanced. So there will be some drawbacks, constraints. So all those constraints have to be properly identified and all these libraries should join together. And you know, it is not only that talking within four walls by library science teachers and library science library practicing librarians will never come out. You know, we can't come out with any significant findings. So for that, though, this is the right time since people have understood automatically based on the force that we have today. So we have to, you know, join hands with the professional association. We all have to come together. Professional associations, policymakers, institutional authorities, and the promotional agencies like, you know, Sea Grants Commission, AACT and all, prospective employers who are, you know, waiting for the people with the new skills, and the domain experts from other countries, we can even have their views, and the librarians of all these four different types of libraries, LAS teachers from different parts of the world, technocrats, corporate librarians, user representatives also we have to have, and finally, interdepartmental experts. You know, put together, we have included almost everybody from every sector. So we have been, you know, screaming about our recognition. So when we have this opportunity to make all these people join our hands together, they also will agree to that. And we also should be prepared for that by join, making all of them understand the power of information and the mode of delivering or disseminating knowledge to the stakeholders by the library professionals will be realized optimally. And we have to all have to be prepared. So this is a golden opportunity for all of us to get connected with everyone in the academic arena. So we have to be prepared for that. So with this, I conclude my speech by proposing my sincere thanks to the founder president, Dr. Hariharan, and my peer speakers and also the audience. Thank you one and all.
Thank you, Professor Sevan sir, for an excellent speech on LAS education and research. Specifically addressed to this COVID-19 on libraries, challenges, opportunity. Very much, sir. So now, I request Dr. Mandrachalam. And he'll be talking about the technology, resources and services.
Sir, sorry to interrupt you. Can I mute my mic, sir? Discussion will be at the end.
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much.
Dr. Mandrachalam, please.
Yeah, good evening, all the participants. And the topic assigned to me to talk about technologies, resources, and services. Okay, I will start with the basic thing required in any library is automation of libraries. For automations, many libraries are using the commercial databases, and many are using the open source automation softwares like Koha. But I think there are libraries with good infrastructure with respect to automation or e-resources or infrastructure. But many libraries like government libraries or public libraries still struggle to implement automation for their resources. So they can use this time as an opportunity to automate their library. How they can automate the library? For many people, they don't know how to automate the library using LMS, library management software. They can learn any open source LMS software like Koha. Now people are start conducting online training programs or online webinars to how to download and how to customize, how to install Koha like softwares. So they can learn the automation softwares. Then in after the institutions will open, they can implement the automation process. But the libraries already installed the automation softwares, whether it is a commercial software or Koha or any other good softwares. They can use this opportunity to update the metadata. In many libraries, the updation of metadata still needs a curation. For example, some of the softwares offer the remote based activities. For example, we are using one of the software like AutoLib. In that software, we have facility to work in our remote using the internet. So they use this opportunity like work from home technology to update the database. Still, there are a lot of areas to update remotely by work from home technology. They make use of this time to update their library automation. And coming to the classification, that is one of the major requirement in any library, particularly to arrange books as per the classification numbers. Still, there are libraries needs to update their classification numbers. They are also using this time to update the classification numbers for the database. They can download the what are all the documents available from the database and update the database. They can use some of the online tools. For example, if they use the DDC, they can use some of the online tools like OCLC, classify.oclc.org to classify the documents. It will definitely help to arrange the books in a proper way in any library. And to complement Dr. J. Dominic, we can also work on the NLIST and National Digital Library access to our users like faculty and students. And we can use this time to upload the bulk uploading the user details in both NLIST or NDL to create user ID and password to all the users. By this way, they can easily create the member details in NLIST and NDL, and to promote NDL or NLIST or any other open educational resources to users. And to add some more points on the remote services, as pointed out by Dr. J. Dominic, we can also use the mobile app based technologies. In our library, we are also using the mobile app based services remotely to the users. And through the mobile app, you can give the access to search all kind of documents available in a particular library. And you can also provide the renewal facility, remote online renewal facility, and also access to question papers of previous years, the question banks. That is one of the important requirement at this time of lockdown. So students needs to prepare for their semesters if it will be happen. So these kind of activities can be activated through mobile apps. And to give access to subscribed e-resources. For example, many libraries are subscribing e-resources, particularly the technical libraries, they are subscribing IEEE, Elsevier or Springer. In this time, they can activate the remote access to users like faculty and students, and some of the remote activation platform are also there, like the Nimbus EZ proxy. But if not possible to purchase these kind of software, they can also go and work with individual websites, like in IEEE or in Science Direct, Elsevier Science Direct, or in IEEE, to create the remote access individually to the users. These kind of facilities in important databases like IEEE or Elsevier or Springer. So they can make use of this also. And another one is to learn and work with the Moodle platform. Yeah, Moodle is not a platform only to faculty members. As a librarian, we can also learn and use the Moodle platform, particularly to create small videos and upload the content in Moodle, like to train the users regarding open educational resources or how to access e-resources, or like an online orientation program to students. So they should also learn Moodle to give some kind of teaching learning to our library users. That's why we have conducted a Moodle training program 2 weeks back in our Salis platform. And lastly, we can also act as a facilitator to some of the important services required by the faculty and students. For example, to support their research needs. Particularly to train them in how to use the Mentally reference management tools or Zotero, any other open source Mentally reference management tools, and also support them in providing the plagiarism checking reports in using some of the tools like Authenticate, Turnitin or Urkund. Similarly, they can also promote the Swayam courses. Now almost all the national coordinators are start providing the online courses for the next semester. So they can promote these courses. These courses can be remotely accessible. There is no need to use Radiant password. Anybody can join these courses in any places using the internet. So we should encourage students and faculty to join in any of the Swayam courses related to their particular domain. In addition to Swayam, we can also promote Coursera, edX or some other online course platforms. And we can also conduct some of them. Now people are start conducting many webinars or online training programs. We can also conduct that kind of training programs to our faculty and students, particularly in the areas like Moodle, Mendeley, or how to use e-resources or and other open educational resources. And particularly for students, we can also conduct quiz on our library systems and services. What are all the systems are available in our library and the services offered by our library. We can conduct quiz and encourage students and motivate students to use the services. And similarly, we can also interact with our library users or the members of library club or reader circle, contact them through some of the platforms like Zoom or GoToMeeting or Google Meet, any other platform. We can contact with them continuously and encourage them to learn. And lastly, as a librarian, we can also learn some of the online tools, how to create small videos, like to provide the online orientation programs. You can use some of the online tools like Screencast-O-Matic or Loom or any other tools to prepare small videos. We can use this locked out time to create small videos about our library service. That videos will be very useful for our future orientation programs. So there are so many opportunities are not a challenges. We can convert it, the challenges as an opportunity to learn many things. You can attend the important webinars related to our library services or systems and make use of this time to create so many things that will be useful for the future library services. Thank you Salis, and thank you team Salis for providing me an opportunity to talk about technologies, resources and services. I pointed out some of the technologies or resources or services. You can also embrace many technologies and learn many things and operate in future. Thank you, Ananda.
Thank you, Dr. Madhurachala.
Thank you, Dr. Madhurachala. Talk about the technology, research and services. And now it's call Dr. Swaminathan.
Swaminathan.
We'll be talking about the
talking about
present and future.
Present and future.
Because we are all not job security. I request Dr. Swaminathan. Swaminathan, please.
Yes, sir. Good evening. Good evening to you all. At the outside, I thank Dr. Harikiran sir and team Salis for giving this nice opportunity. I'm audible, sir?
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Okay. Thank you. The topic given to me is career and employment, present and future. So we thought as librarians at various levels, we know that some of the important skills, skill sets, like communication skill, information communication technology skill, time management skill, leadership skill, these are all common skill. Whatever the period it may be, it may be a COVID or before COVID or after COVID-19. That is not an issue. So apart from that, we need some of the some other skills exclusively for after COVID-19. I feel that the skill of collaboration, that is very, very essential nowadays. because librarians in the position to have collaborate with inter department collaboration or intra department collaboration, inter college collaboration, so that we have to conduct many programs. These are the one of the new skill that is required. And another one is out of box thinking skill. It's essentially required. Today, just went through one of the mail shared by Mr. Mohan in the Salis group. Now in the US, in one of the states, the librarian, she used drones to circulate the books. So the libraries, most of the libraries and the education institutions are kept closed. But she opened the library and she's circulating the books through the drones. So this way we have to think how to reach our readers. That is very, very important. Out of box thinking skill is very, very essential. And another important skill is saving skill. That is, we never studied this in the textbooks. But last 6 months, especially from after March, it gives some new kind of skills that is required. Saving, we cannot spend because the future is uncertainty. I know that some of our friends, most of our friends are working in the self-financing colleges. They are struggling to get a salary, not only a librarian. All even faculty members and all. Even it is not sure that librarians or faculty members who are working in the government and government-aided institutions also. Now already they stopped for the DA. And I came to know that this year they are going to stop the increment also. I'm not sure how far it is correct. So this particular another 2 or 3 years, we should be very careful. Whatever the amount we earn, we have to deposit carefully. That is very, very important. That is a unique skill. Is required. And another important skill during the COVID or after COVID-19 is maintaining a good mental and physical health skills. That is very, very important. We cannot simply ignore it, especially the librarians who are working with 40 plus. We have to go through medical checkup, and we have to make our physical health and mental health physical to be fit. Otherwise, it is very difficult. We have to develop multitasking skill also, because the employer they put all kind of pressure to us hereafter. Even the librarians in private colleges, irrespective of whether in government or government aided, we are getting lot of pressures. So we have now because they. They're thinking that these people are earning so much, why they have to work more things? They are expecting a lot of things from us. So multitasking skill is essential, and the skill of generating income, not only for your employer, for you also. I'm glad to say this because some of my friends who are working in some private colleges as a faculty member, they used to get a salary in very delay, especially they may not get the salary in the month of April or May. I used to ask them how they are maintaining. They said they are taking tuitions. So they, same way the librarians also try to think over it. I'm not talking about the librarians who are working who are earning very good salary in the government sector. I am very concerned about the librarians who are working in the private institution. Try to find out the possibilities of generating the income. Please, we don't depend only on our employer. This is one of my best suggestions. And as for the qualities which are required, we should have a proper open-mindedness, and we should develop our EQ, emotional quotient. And another important quality is willing to accept changes. Willing to accept changes. Because life is uncertainty, and respect other values. These are the apart from the communication skill. I hope Dr. Ila is there. Dr. Mandrachalam already spoke about ICT skill and all. And leadership skill and all. I think Dr. Ila sir, he will brief it. So apart from that, librarian, we try to develop acquisition of new knowledge skills. That is very, very essential. Okay, everybody knows we have to develop a skill, but the question is how to do it, how to improve our skills. For that, we should have a strong attitude, a strong interest, a willingness to learn. That is very, very essential. So we have to ready to prepare and utilize the opportunity, you know, properly. Whenever any opportunity comes, we don't miss it. And as a friends, you all aware that, you know, ICT provides a lot of opportunities to learn, especially the YouTube. It provides wonderful resources. We can learn many things. So for that, we have a strong mindset to learn. And in order to maintain, you know, our retain our position in the employment, we need the following things. Try to understand the vision, mission of the institution and the authorities. In fact, their likes and dislikes. And we have to play a vital, proactive role. Take additional responsibility. I cannot say that I will look after only library-related matter. No, hereafter, don't say that I will look after only library-related activities. We have to take multi-task responsibility. And my sincere request to the librarians who are working in the colleges or universities, we have to travel along with the other faculty members and don't say no immediately to our authorities. Because you are all librarians, you know the real situation. Don't say no immediately and contribute as an academic and not as a librarian alone. That is very, very important. We have to show our holistic approach. But meantime, we don't forget about our library and library users. And because why I'm list out these are the quality skill set, because the present we have the following challenges. One is uncertainty. There is a decrease in the students' admission in the colleges, especially in the private colleges. For in the context of government institutions, there is a lack in fund issues are there. Funding is one of the important challenges even in the government institutions. So it reflects in the salaries, even especially for the middle level and senior level. We have to face a lot of issues. Always we have to prove that, you know, we are workful to the institution. It's a very, very important challenge in front of us. And another important challenge is, you know, due to the work pressure, we should in the position to keep a balance between the workplace and personal life. And we have to, another important task is, you know, the multitasking capacity that we should develop. So these are the challenges, you know, based on that, I propose some of the skill set and qualities. I hope, you know, during the discussion as a senior librarians, you can also, you know, give your ideas so that it will be worthful to all. Once again, I thank the opportunity to the team Chalice for this wonderful opportunity. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Swaminathan. But you guys spoke about some sensitive issues as well as the precautionary measures that library has to be adopted or to be taken in this hour of crisis. Because as you said, we should not say anything to no. We have to change according to the situation. We have to respond to the situation because the survival of the fittest now has been changed. So we have to respond whatever situation there, we have to adapt ourselves, we have to come again. And that's very, very important. As you said, one important thing, management, whatever says now, we have to first obey it, and then later on you can convince them later on if possible. But within this, I would request the next, I would call the next speaker. 1 minute. So now we are moving to the public library services. And now I ask Dr. Suryanarayanan, our president. And former librarian of Sri Paramakalyani College, Alaruthi. It is one of the reputed colleges in the southern part of Tamil Nadu. And he has vast knowledge of more than 34 years in this field. And I request Dr. Suryanarayanan to talk about the public library services because it is another area of concern. You know that in New York and many places, many libraries have been shut down. And there is no immediate, they are not going to have any plan for immediate opening. But they already started certain services the remote side. So now let us request our Dr. Suryanarayan to talk about public library services. Later on we discuss any other issues. Dr. Suryanarayan, please.
Dear founder president Dr. Hariharan, my dear Chalice professional friends, I'm really happy to stand before you to discuss the libraries in COVID-19, especially the public libraries, which have been closed almost in all over the world during this period. The speakers who have spoken before my talk, they have given some of their experiences in their institutions, but this talk has been designed by analyzing the situations in various countries, and I have given this as a capsule. When the lockdown has been imposed, almost all the nations, the public library, including public libraries, all the institutions have been closed. In most of the countries, American Samoa, Algeria, Bangladesh, Bhutan, Brazil, Colombia, Egypt, Luxembourg, Malaysia, Mauritius, India, Portugal, Russia, almost in all the nations, all the public libraries have been closed. But later on, with some restrictions and by taking some precautionary measures, some of the nations have tried to open the services of the public libraries. The libraries in American Samoa, Algeria, Bangladesh, Bhutan, RICA have closed their libraries. But the nations, Orland Islands, Australia, Austria, Belgium, Bulgaria, Canada, France, Germany, Hong Kong, Ireland, Italy, Japan, Lebanon, Netherlands, New Zealand, Poland, Spain, and Switzerland, they have taken some precautionary measures and tried to open the libraries and started the service. In Sweden, 90% of the municipalities have kept to open the libraries. 85% of the municipalities in Sweden, they are rendering the extended service also. When they started to do the services again, they have put so many restrictions. According to that, we shall classify the libraries rendering the services in four types. The first type is the libraries which have laid down certain health and hygiene recommendations among the library workers and provide all the library services without any interruption. And another section of the parts of the libraries functioning with certain restrictions to admit the number of users to using the library resources. And third type of libraries are doing the library services by minimizing certain services. They block certain services and provide some of the services. And the fourth type of libraries have completely closed their library services, and the library staff have been deputed to do the corona lockdown work by joining with the government officials and the NGOs. These are the situations in all over the world. When reopening with the relaxing the restrictions, some of the libraries have starting to make plans for gradual reopening. When rules, permissions, and library buildings and resources themselves permits this to happen, and make necessary changes to library policies, even carrying out a risk assessment focuses both on library activities and the wider situation. And in some places, setting limits on number of people using the library at one time. It could be established by accepting examples through advanced booking, reservation, and ticketing, or using other means by counting the number of users. And using one-way systems, limiting furnitures, keeping reading rooms closed, or continuing to postpone certain programs and keeping especially the toilets closed, they are started to enter the services. And implementing regular cleaning processes in the library, especially focused on surface where the virus appears to be able to last for long loss. And developing the click and collect or drive through services in order to allow access to goods without human contact. And they have developed the protocols how to respond if someone with symptoms identified in library. They could be quarantined or they should be sent for medical treatment. If this library is staff, and he should be given the leave and ask him to be isolated in the home. Ensuring staff have the equipment of training necessary to stay safe, including condition of screens if necessary, limiting contacts as far as possible, and enabling work from home for as long as possible. The library persons have also been asked to stay in their homes and carry out the library works. Continuing to promote online services resources in order to limit number of people to visit the library. And all the circulars and declarations should be communicated clearly about all the new rooms to the library users, both online and on-site.
Suryanay, please.
Sir Surinarayan, sir, please unmute your mic and speak again.
Kindly see that your mic is unmuted, muted, because even one person makes some mistake, the whole proceeding will get collapsed.
Okay. And when doing the traditional service, the library professionals have to follow the certain things. They have problems in the books received after the use. So some of the librarians have asked the library users to keep the books with them, and they may be returned after the books are over. In Ireland and Switzerland, Netherlands and Belgium, the books have been quarantined for 72 hours. In Australia and England, the returned materials have been quarantined for 24 hours. In Egypt, they have decided that the sunlight is enough for the de-infection. But in Czechoslovakia, 48 hours they have imposed the quarantine. In France, 10 days for plastic coated materials and 72 hours for paper materials. But the computers and other information communication technological tools have been identified as the devices having carried out high leaders. So they should be sanitized frequently and being used. Here we have potentially contaminated books close to traps. They have asked the users to drop the books on the book traps which have been put up on the gates, dedicated return desks, or even baskets around the library for returning the materials for consultation. All the libraries.
Please unmute your mic, Dr. Sayan. Please unmute your mic.
So all the libraries have asked the library professionals to have the gloves for handling the new returned materials. And after that, they have been advised to throw it away. And regular hand wash is also insisted for the library professionals. Remote service will be effective in this corona period. especially the digital library service. The libraries have also started the websites, and other social media has also been used for doing the library service. Put its digital content at the front of the website. And some of the libraries are running online book clubs. And some of the libraries are having the program of the librarian reference sessions in social media, that is in Facebook and other things. And they have conducted the virtual exhibitions by using the social medias. Increasing the number of e-books that popular can borrow at any given time for poor people, for the people needy to apply for benefits or look for jobs, the career guidance have been given. And in this coronavirus period, has given a new thing for the library information professionals to continue their story times through online. Then Authors on Your Screen service is also another program by introducing the authors of the NewLib books. And all traditional services could be carried out by taking certain precautionary measures by the public libraries. Introducing the digital library and e-library services, as now users are different, because in those days the library, public library users were only the aged persons, retired persons and others. But now the students have been enrolled as the users in many of the branch libraries. And the unemployed youth have also joined in mass in the public libraries and utilizing the library materials. The collections are, in those days the collections were just to give the recreation to the public. But nowadays the collections in public libraries are especially helpful for the students for doing out their curriculum. And the career guidance literature have been developed for the use of the young and unemployed youth for developing themselves for getting the jobs by appearing in competitive exams and others. Introducing the digital library and e-library services as new users are different. And organizing WhatsApp groups is also possible. E-resources shall be sent for home reading. Even the mobile library services could be operated for promoting e-resources, because the mobile library services have been started by Dr. S.R. Ranganathan in those days. And in nowadays also in most of the district central libraries are the having the mobile vans for conducting the book exhibitions and promoting reading habits. But they could be converted as the e-library center to be taken to the remote villages and provide the e-library service to the users in the remote areas. At least in district central library level, a consortium could be started for promoting the group discussions, coaching classes, and conducting webinars and conducting various competitions. Now they are conducting it in the library premises itself, but in future it could be conducted through webs and webinars and platforms. The branch library shall provide local information and promoting reading awareness. The branch libraries could function as an agency for approaching the e-resources. So with this, I conclude my talk, and I will come in the discussion after that. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Suryanarayan, for addressing the various issues about that are facing by the public library, and what are the steps they are taking in various countries to plan for the reopening, and even during this period also how they can deliver certain services like mobile services, online services, all those things you have mentioned. And thank you very much for your presentation. Now it is now the time to talk about the corporate social responsibility. Friends, actually it is one of the mandatory requirements nowadays. You can every stop, they have to take part in the CSR activities, corporate social responsibility. As I would like to mention here, SALIS is also an organization. We have also CSIR, corporate social responsibility. Actually, that is promoting the reading habit. Apart from that, we have also contributed a little bit to the Chief Minister Relief Fund, we have many of our members, you know, more than 50 members contributed, and then we have collected 50,000 rupees, and we sent it to Chief Minister Relief Fund 50,000 rupees and because of Sally, and also we are sending another 10,000 rupees from Sally's fund to the Prime Minister Relief Fund. So this is a set of social responsibility, corporate social responsibility. Each and every individual and each and every organization should have this one. So now is the right time to know more about CSIR as well as how we could do this kind of services to the students or the public or whatever. So it's a time I request our speaker, Dr. Captain T. Mahudeswaran, to talk about this particular topic. Dr. Mahudeswaran, please. Dr. Mahudeswaran? Dr. Mahudeswaran, are you there? Dr. Mahudeswaran, please. Maybe you can unmute your mic. Dr. Mahudeswaran, please. Maybe I will call Dr. Ilavalagan. Later we can call Dr. Mahudeswaran. Dr. Ilavalagan, are you there, please? Dr. Ilavalagan, sir?
Yes, sir.
I request Dr. K. Ilavalagan, librarian and chief knowledge officer, IIM Trichy, and also our current president, to talk about the skills to cope up with the changes. Dr. Ilavalagan, sir, please.
Respected moderator and founder president of SALIS, Dr. Hariharan. Respected panelists, my dear friends across the country, a good evening. It's a pleasure to deliver or interact with you on the topic our skills to cope up with the change. The first thing is, I think we are all overacting on certain things because all these things are revolving around the COVID-19. By mistake, we have pressed the panic button rather than the caution button. Now, there is no need that you have to be panic the situation prevailing today. We need to be cautious. First and foremost, you have to remember the change is the permanent. And COVID create a situation, this can be here today. And tomorrow it may be disappeared. So first thing, you have to take off the panic, but you have to be cautious. When we talk about the moment you remember or realize, it is going to be a short span of time in our life. Maybe it is going to be there for next 6 months. It may slightly affect both physically and mentally, economically, individually, society, and then government. It is going to affect every one of us. But it is only a transition. That change is a permanent. It is going to be today, may not be there tomorrow, transit. So don't bother too much about the COVID-19. Now, when we talk about, if that is the case, if I don't want to bother too much about the COVID-19, let me be very cautious. Then if that is, I have to be cautious, then what are things that I need to do? I need to perform today. I can't do without doing performance. I need to do my work, whether I'm sitting at home or in the office. I need to do my job. Now, if I want to do my job at home, instead of going to the office, perform the job, there I think probably the skill set has come. Most of us are more successful, some of us are actually failing, some of us are miserably failing to perform our duties during this COVID-19. Maybe there is a reason we are not able to use the skills. It is there already. You don't buy anywhere, you don't learn anywhere. Any skill you talk about, it is there with you. You have to believe in yourself. Only thing is, you have to identify what type of skill I need to take, what type of skill that I have to execute today. Tomorrow this may not be relevant. I may use little less percentage today. Which one I have to use heavily so that I can showcase or I can say that I'm fit? That's an important. When we talk about skills, are we talking about life skills? Are we talking about the soft skills? Are we talking about the hard skill? Which one? There are skills. When we talk about skills, there are too many things. There are a lot of combinations. Most probably during this particular period, we have to focus more on life skills, not the soft skills and then the hard skills. Life skill is more important. Your life is more than anything else. Career becoming second, but life is important. But at the same time, I have to perform my job. How do I do that? That is where the question stands. Now, the question is very important. How do I perform my job? Now, I have the soft skill, I have the life skills, I have the technical, I have the hard skill. But here, I think most probably people who are more technical savvy, probably they can able to deliver what they want to deliver, what the people are expecting. So probably you try to sharpen the technological skill during this particular period. That actually going to help us to perform our job in a normal way. We need not do anything extraordinary. We are not actually facing any challenges. Understand, we are not facing any challenges which really need extraordinary effort from our side. And we are not facing any challenges. We are facing only change. That again, it is going to be a temporary in a period. Perform our job sitting at home. That's all we need to do that. Being a librarian or a teacher, what is that I need to do? Probably you know that we have a different community. If you're an academic community, it's easy for you to reach your academic community using technology. If you are a public librarian, I think little difficult for you your job, because I have to think about, when we talk about the librarians, it most of us focusing on an academic librarians. For their role is much simpler, much easier. They can perform. They are more actually familiar with the technology, the sources that they use, the people, set of people who are coming. They know exactly what is that. They are fixed. But in the case of people who works in the public libraries, corporate libraries, and school libraries, I think they have a different set of people. Their expectations are different, and nature of demanding is completely different. I think most probably those people need a different set of skills more than what they have the technological skill. So people who works, we can put in two different ways. One set of people just focusing only the higher education institutions, for them I don't think there is any problem. Only thing is, you have to perform. You may have the problem. For example, you might be a problem of your pay scale may not be paid on time. The moment the library opens, you are not very sure whether the job will be there or not, or you will not get the same job, you will get something else. All those things are there. These are all panic buttons. Remember, these things will be there for next 6 months. Maybe after the COVID, 3 months over or 6 months over, the impact will be there for another 3 to 6 months or more than 9 months. After that, it is going off. You will become a normal life. So don't worry about that. We are not too much bothered about the panic. Now, during this period, what skill I have to use? For example, if I am the librarian working in the university or college, now, how do I perform my duty? I need to satisfy, I need to engage my user community. How do I do that? I think probably the online is the best platform. Whether you want to deliver, whether you want to provide, whether you want to engage, you have the virtual space. Probably you can able to interact with your community. You can provide what they need. that is impossible. But the person who works in the public libraries, how do he can perform? What is the skill that he need? He cannot go, he is not technologically well versed, but still there are people who works in the public libraries doing extremely good job. They, I think, probably exploit the skill that they have got, the social media penetration skills. I think they use the social media very effectively, and then they are the one actually mixing with the society. They actually go to the society, supporting the society when compared with anybody else. We are actually only thinking about providing the information, whereas the public librarian goes, mix with the society, they take extra care, the socially they mixed with the people. They are not actually mixed with the people only for the content, only for the intelligence, the knowledge delivery. They also mix socially. They engage with the people socially, because they need probably more life skills when compared with the person who actually deliver only content through technology or the social media. Then coming to the school libraries, there are school librarians and then school teachers. Maybe the teacher turned as the librarian or librarian turned as the teacher, either way. But how do they actually satisfy? I think this is the right time, this is the right scenario and environment, then probably you can exploit the situation. This is the time that we can actually inculcate more actually reading habit among the kids, because the diversion is less for the kids. They can actually easily, we can bring them into the fold. We can able to provide different kind of activities. It is activity in the sense, not necessarily anything related to the education. Maybe a lot of fun activities you can give. You can interact with them. Probably that actually helps the school librarians. Don't give an assignment, homework. That is all the teacher's work. Being a school librarian, you try to interact and then attend those people, provide some kind of, you know, fun activities. There are many things are available, gamifications are available. There are many things. Probably you interact with them through the social media or your school website or your school portal. Something you need to do that, then probably that is the best way. So the skill in overall, if you're asking me, one is, first thing, you have to accept the change. Second thing is, don't react too much, because we are all reacting too much unnecessarily. There is no need that you have to react too much. And another important thing is, find works, the what works for you, that you do it. Don't do anything extraordinary. If it doesn't know, don't try, don't fail it. It is not the time for you to do something extraordinary things to fail it. Second important thing is, don't compare how people are doing others. Don't worry about it, whether others do or not, it is none of your business. What you need to do is what you can able to deliver, but you deliver very sincerely, honestly. That's an important. And the things that you want to do it on your own way. Let it be good enough. Don't do anything extraordinary. So if you think that these things will definitely helping you, but when we talk about certain skills, probably you have to remember this is the time for you to think about, maybe we are talking about the critical thinking, which really helping us the qualitative and quantitative reasoning. Probably that actually help us to deliver on time what people expected. And this is the time for us to take a lot of initiative, because you have to be more and more innovative. Maybe you use technology or services, whatever that you use, try to initiate as much as possible. And very importantly, this is the time for you to adaptability. You have to be more adaptable for the situation. Be flexible. If there is a work is given at 9 o'clock in the evening, try to take it and then try to help people. That's an important. Don't say that this is not the time for me. Too much of you might be having your own compassion at home, but still this is not the right time that show all those things. Be more flexibility. And very importantly, this is the time for you. It's a golden opportunity. Every one of us influencing others, because we are living in the networking world. This is a good opportunity, good time for us influence others. So very importantly, you need to have the influencing skill, because that we are lacking on that. Because we are sitting and then delivering, whether reactively or proactively, we never have the habit or the situation of, you know, influencing people. And this is a good time that our footfalls are come down. I think this is the right time that we have to use it properly to build the relationship, so that the academic community, even they leave the organization, they remember us, then they will actually, through the mouth of word, they will actually market what service that we have done. They can remember us, so that actually we can, our position and then our actually profession will be remembered forever. And this will actually help us. They are fit into the society. We are, our services are essential forever. And importantly, it's a good time for us. Some of us are not good in communication, particularly oral as well as written. probably this is a time given by the God. We have to try to use and enhance our communication skill, and also try to use as much as possible you market yourself. That's an important, because many of us do quite good job and we never actually tell outside world that what we have done, because it is your responsibility. You have to tell what you have done, because marketing is very important. You have to sell yourself, particularly people who works in the private colleges, people who works in the public private sectors. I think you have to tell, unless you tell that during this particular period or over the period of what you have done, they may not know, they may not recognize you. It's a time for you to tell yourself about others, right? Then other important thing is leading people. I think many of us may not have the leadership quality, but I think it's a time for you to take the leadership quality, try to take the lead, even if it is one or two, or at least to take the project, lead the team, and then help it. Now this is the time for you to advocate lifelong learning, because now it is the time for every one of us to realize lifelong learning is an important. Probably you can actually use other resources which people cannot able to get it. For example, there are a lot of open access OERs are available. You can actually sell all those things to the people, because it may be structured, unstructured. Properly, you can take those data, you can put it in the proper format where people will love to take the in a fashionable way. Then I think you have time that you can able to exploit all those things. And where we actually are lacking is the interviewing. We don't have the face-to-face interaction. We are not good at the face-to-face interactions. I think probably that we need to improve. And this is a time for us. We have to understand many search engines, many applications are available. How do we use it? How we can actually use those applications to reach the end user. And probably this is a time we are actually not good at documentation, analyzing the data, and then retrieval certain things which is very essential, especially for people who are not in the normal mode. For example, we never thought about people who physically challenged, visually challenged. We generally thinking about our delivery and product and services meant for the general public. They can able to access on their own, but there are people who required information. They cannot able to do that. They need support. So probably you have to think about people who are physically challenged and visually challenged. Okay, I'm sorry, sir. Thank you very much. I'll stop here.
Thank you, sir. You can continue in the question answer session. So now actually I call Dr. Maudi, sir.
Sir, can you hear me, sir? Yeah, can you hear me, sir?
Yes, please, Dr. Maudi, sir, you can talk about
Very good evening to Dr. Hariharan, founder, president, and moderator for today's discussion. SALIS webinar series 20, Librarians, Open Conclave on Impact of COVID-19 on Libraries, Challenges and Opportunities. Now I am going to share my ideas on corporate social responsibility and extension services rendered by the librarians during the lockdown period. Corporate social responsibility is a gesture of showing the company or institute or librarian's concern and commitment towards society's sustainability and development. Simply says that CSR is the ethical behavior of a company or a institute or a librarians to the society. Being a librarian, we have our own academic responsibility, that is, provide information services to our users to fulfill their academic and research needs. But we are also have some social responsibility to serve our society through extension services. Extension service means provide extra service to the society. It is not a new concept. It was introduced by our father of library science, Dr. S. R. Ranganathan. When he was a librarian of University of Madras, he introduced mobile library system. Now we can call it as a extension services. During lockdown period, some other extension services we can carry out. Before starting extension service, we should conduct a small survey to understand the real needs of the local community, and we need to collaborate with the local industry, because the local industry have a lot of resources, the community have a lot of needs. It is a duty of the librarian to meet the resources and the needs. Just we act as an intermediator. I have few examples for extension services carried out in Erode. In Erode, the Department of Library and Information Science and the Library of Vellalar College for Women discussion with their students. During the discussion, students are expressed their problems that they have a lot of agricultural products produced by the poor farmers. There is no proper place to store the products and no way to sell it because of lockdown. The department staff have approached the MSSRF, MS Swaminathan Research Foundation, to solve their problem. They have arranged a community development program through Zoom app, where the MSSRF scientists interact with the farmers directly, and they arranged buyers for their agricultural product. That was a very effective program and appreciated by all. It was happened just last month in Erode. Like that, you can also arrange some program in your area. Before starting the program, we should have a small survey to understand real needs of your area. Then you can extend your extension services. The another example is, always there is a financial crunch in library. So we contact some industry for CSR fund, because each and every industry should allot some amount from their net profit as a CSR fund. I think it's a 2% of their net profit. The Salis Erode chapter have 4 projects with the CSR fund. In Erode, many industrialists have formed Olirim Erode Foundation, like as NGO. All the Olirim Erode Foundation members contributed some amount from their CSR fund to the Olirim Erode Foundation. Olirim Erode Foundation offering many services to Erode city, like maintaining lakes to save water, plant trees, and to provide medical equipment to the government hospital to serve needy people. We, Salis Erode chapter members, approached the Olirim Erode officials and asked financial assistance to promote reading habit of public of Erode city. We have started a smart cubes, means reading center at the Erode railway station. It is maintained by the Salis and the expenditure will be made by the Olirim Erode Foundation. Like that, we can also started mini library at the Teachers Colony Park at Erode. The same way, the training and training are given by the Salis Erode chapter member, and the expenditure will be made by the Olirim Erode. The another type of extension services, village adoption. I am a librarian and the NCC officer also. We have adopted a village nearer to our college and making computer literacy awareness to the children of the village regularly with our cadets and students. And many social awareness program also we organized. Now, the Salis Erode chapter have planned to adopt nearby village named Karapare slum, because slum area children are not able to afford a smartphone and a laptop. Now, Tamil Nadu government have many online courses. Even school syllabus books are also published with the QR code. We have planned to ask the all the slum children in a particular place, and we'll get financial assistance from the Olirim Erode Foundation. From the financial assistance, we have planned to brought TV or smart board, mic, etc. We ask the children to sit on place and watch online courses through TV or smart board. We can make some awareness announcements also through mic. Like that, we can conduct many programs. We have planned to provide some medical assistance to the medical assistance and awareness to the slum area children. Like that, we can extend our extension services to contribute librarian for the corporate and society social responsibility. With this, I conclude my views and ideas. If you have any doubt or any clarification, we can meet in the discussion session. Thank you, one and all, for your patient listen.
Thank you, Dr. Mohdeeswara. And you clearly spoke about the importance of CSR activities, and you also listed various activities that have been undertaken at Erode with the help of the Olirim Foundation and your future plan. So it's the time we can provide some community services online also to the children, like story telling and other thing. Thank you for your excellent services. Now it's a time for
discussion, a question answer session. And on behalf of the participant, I tell you, they might have come with a certain question in their mind. So I thought we can ask certain question on behalf of the participant first, you know, one or two question, and then at the end, you know, for each participant, I would like to ask actually two questions, and on behalf of participant, after that we can move on to the what you call it. We will open the discussion for the members. Okay. So now I will ask it, Professor. One minute. Sorry. Are you able to see the screen?
Yes, sir.
No, one minute. Sir. This one? Professor Sevak on screen?
Sir, I can see. It is visible.
Okay, sir. Sir, can you see the question?
Sir, this is guidelines.
Sir, I think, sir, I am sharing the screen.
Oh, okay, that is a problem. Okay. So okay. Now there are two questions.
Okay, can I close that screen sharing?
Yes. I will share it.
Okay, thank you.
Professor, there are two questions.
Yes, sir.
Actually, these questions as I have framed, you know, on behalf of the participant. In the sense, okay, they may be thinking to ask these kind of questions. So first, let me ask two questions from each speakers. Then we'll open to the forum to the audience. Your answer should be very brief, and you should not take more than 5 minutes. At least 1 or 2 minutes for each question, sir. How can the librarian support teaching learning system with the changing pedagogy if COVID-19 pandemic continues?
Yeah. Thank you, sir, for a valid question raised. And as Dr. Ilavalagan sir rightly pointed out, it is only a temporary issue. If it continues, we have to be prepared, and the whole set of talks given by different experts would give answers. Still, it is my pleasant duty to give the answer to this particular question. How can the librarian support teaching learning system with the changing pedagogy if a COVID-19 pandemic continues? So now, let us take only one example. This, when the UGC prompted the universities and colleges to check for plagiarism to avoid this reproduction of, duplicate information. So they all, unanimously decided to, nominate library as a place where we can go for checking this, documents for plagiarism, that too for similarity ratio. So that is what happened. In the same way, in future, when I was, mentioning about the ill-equipped infrastructure, if you ask the Department of Library Information Science in our department, when the university is asking me to immediately go for online teaching and also share all my resources, whatever I have, but the current infrastructure will not support. So instead of that, what the management may think in future, if this system continues, they may establish a central facility, maybe the library may be preferred, as they prefer to check plagiarism. So in that place, we have to be prepared to support, the supporting can be in the form of scheduling the lectures, online lectures, and also providing supplement material to the speakers if they want, and also informing the readers about the program, and also getting feedback from the readers, and also about a particular speaker, and providing links to the other related talks. So all those things, you know, will be part of the profession for librarians even if this COVID-19 pandemic continues. So here we have to be prepared with the skills whatever the experts have spoken today, including life skills. That is what Dr. Yavalagan sir mentioned. It is very much required now. So we are always, you know, we are all in crisis. Because of crisis, stress also develops. So if we are able to gradually learn all these skills, you know, by which we may be in a position to support the teaching learning system with changing pedagogy. And also other another challenge what I have told mentioned in my talk is that we cannot expect that every faculty will be well acquainted with the online teaching. For them also we have to give them training. For that, you know, like we do information literacy program in the library, it is done by the librarians, and also we just have user orientation with the new products whatever we receive. So this also maybe I guess that this would be additional responsibility for the librarians to support our teaching learning system, you know, with the changing pedagogy, as I told you before that. So online will be more in terms of ratio of teaching than the conventional teaching. For at least some time, as Ilavalam sir mentioned, it may go up to 9 months, 6 to 9 months. So for which we have to be prepared, because if we simply say that users, only few users are coming to the library, and we don't have anything to do, so that cannot be done. We have to, you know, volunteer ourselves to support the system for, you know, achieving the mission of the institution. We have to always work for the parent organization's objectives. So since our library is the subsystem of the whole system, so we cannot you know, say no to the thing, you know, whatever is insisted or proposed by the management. So for which we have to be always prepared. So with this we'll be able to support the teaching learning system, ultimately making the available resources, including infrastructure, use of optimally for, you know, a greater productivity by any organization in the academic institutions. So I think I have answered the first question. If it is fine,
the second question, actually, we expect your brief answer, sir, because other speakers are there. What would be the role of LL schools to meet the changing needs of stakeholder in a crisis environment? Should be very brief.
Yeah, this since we people all, you know, experts talk about the change which is happening and the transformation also that takes place. So the first and foremost thing which has to be addressed here is that we have to revamp the entire curriculum, incorporating the components which are required, particularly the new competencies required for various professionals, and also these ICT components which are essentially required to meet the changing needs of the people, stakeholders, particularly this online environment. So for that we have to do. And also, as I have already mentioned in my earlier talk, this bibliometric tool, it is a very good indicator to measure the quantitative outcomes, whatever is happening either during COVID or after, for which we need to have a little bit of statistics and mathematical knowledge. So that also has to be incorporated in the LAS curriculum. The first and foremost, LAS schools have to change their curriculum, and also they have to work with the librarians, because librarians are going to face a lot of challenges in the near future. So whenever they come across some challenges, those challenges have to be brought to the notice of the LA schools. So, you know, we can work in the coordinated manner to resolve the issue, and by finding a solution, you know, by discussing with each other, we may come out with a better solution. That solution can be implemented easily. And third thing also, these associations also have to play a crucial role to actually educate people. So this first and foremost thing is revamping the curriculum and joining hands with library association and the librarians to impart new skills to the stakeholders, and also to offer short-term courses to keep our you know, librarians and the people from our domain up to date with the latest developments. So this is my brief answer, sir, as you requested.
For your excellent answer. And now I would request Dr. Elavalan, actually you have the message which you got from your speech, actually don't be panic and but you should be very cautious. That the message you were given. But I want to ask you two questions. We expect a brief answer from you. What are the skills are required to serve the users in the prevailing COVID-19 situation? A very brief answer. In a nutshell, so that the participant would get the point.
Yeah, if you are asking me the skills you require to serve in the prevailing situation, most probably I can actually prefer the life skills, because it's basically psychosocial ability. When we talk about life skills, it covers everything, including your psychology, your ability, how you are adapting, how you are behaving, so that the individual can able to deal effectively. As an individual, how I can able to effectively deal the demand actually from the user side. For example, we are talking about the users, they are actually studying in the institutions. But there are people, now this is a different situation, there are people, they are about to leave, they are not still leaving. For example, the final year student, they are in the college. 11th, 12th standard student, still they are in the school. They are not left because their examination is not passed. There are students who just crossed 10th standard. You just think about those people. We are giving online education through different mode to the student who continuing. But we never thought about the student who supposed to leave the organization, but still they are with us. Now, how do we support those people? That's an important. If you really need a kind of skill, identify what exactly they need. For example, student who leave the college, fourth year student, he just waiting for examination. He might be finishing at any given time. His main thing is the panic mode is employment, because next 1 year going to be tough for employment, either it's an existing employee or a potential employee going to be a problem. So how you can able to actually help those things? There, I think probably our life skill going to help us, our social, behavioral ability, psycho ability really going to help. So probably you have to focus on your life skills, which will help you as well as the other people also. That's one. So that's I finished. Next. Sir, I have finished my answer for the first question.
Hello.
Yeah, I'll move on to the second question. And second question, please.
What are the other essential skills are required to cope up with the change? See, for example, assume that this will continue for another few months. What the skills are required to cope up with the situation?
Right. Being a librarian, if you're asking me as a librarian, as a teacher, there are two roles I have to play, because I think some of them will be a teacher, some of them will be a librarian. If you're a librarian, if you're asking me what is the skill immediately I need during this particular period and I have to employ, one is my budgeting skill, because now everywhere the funds are cut. Assuming that when people are not willing to give money, if you are going to give the money to the institution, because institution will not give the salary to you, they may ask you to leave the organization. If this is the situation, you think reversely. You tell the institution that I like to give you money. How do I get that skill set? Now, instead of generating money, if you are cutting your own expenditure, that itself is a kind of saving. So where will I cut my expenditure? As a librarian, there is a huge budget. Even if it's a school library, there will be 100 rupees budget will be there. Instead of taking money from the institute, school, you give 100 rupees to the institution. How do I do that? One, you stop actually spending unwanted things. Generally, we have the budget of selling certain things. First thing, you have to stop. How do I stop? There are materials freely available. Being a librarian, I think you are the qualified person to evaluate which is good, which is not good, which is authentic, which is reliable, which is going to help immediately, and what is the benefit it is going to give the user community, that we know very well. So probably there we have to focus more. And this is the time that there are a lot of organizations trying to support the community. So use those institutions who are all the people can able to support the academic institution as well as the public library. So probably you identify, negotiate, send the proposal, try to get the money. Now you think about it, your job is secured, people will appreciate. This is the time that we have to perform extremely differently. That's an important. So probably if somebody asking me, Barnes, how you are managing your financial skill, you might be say that I don't have the financial skill, I don't have the finance at all. that will taken care of the institute, but still you can able to identify where you can able to get money for the institute. I'm talking about not money part. It may be resources, it may be some other asset. You can try to bring it, you think about it, you bring that skill, probably that will actually help you more and more. So probably these are the essential skill which you can able to required to cope of the change if the situation continues next 9 months or 1 year. I'll stop there.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for your excellent explanation. Actually, as a librarian, we have two roles to play. One is, as a librarian, we have to manage the budget, acquire the resources, and provide a service to the users. Another, as a staff, we need to take care of ourselves, our safety, security, health issues, and our employment opportunities and threats. So thank you, sir. So next, we'll move on to...
Sir, excuse me. Hello?
No, we'll ask all other questions at the end. We'll quickly go through that one. So I request...
Can I...
Please, you can ask at the end,
Pranav,
please.
Okay, it's not my question, but I wanted to add one more skill along with this Dr. Ilavalagan sir and Dr. Sehgal.
You can add it
in this point.
With the time, no? The time is very essential. You can ask. So, Dr. Mandrachala, so I expect your answer to be very, very brief because the time is going. And as you already mentioned about the technology, resources, and services, you know, on the one side, the allied institutions like IIT, IIM, and then universities, and then and aided engineering colleges like you have a lot of resources and other things. So now the question is here to only the manage the resources and acquire certain skill and deliver the service. That is the one essential thing. In another question, in the absence of this one, for example, technology and resources, the institutions just like, you know, arts and science college, general engineering college, they have halfway through automation. And they do not have much resources, much staff members. So how they can cope up with this situation? How they provide services in the absence of the technology and resources? I request you to answer these questions by taking only a little time. Very briefly, please answer.
Sir, I think I have already mentioned about the possible remote services. They can use the available online tools to learn things for library services, particularly the remote services, and they can also start providing. For example, I am talking about the online orientation program from remotely. For example, now we can conduct a program through any other online platforms to educate students about OER or any other training required in the fields like Moodle or Mentally. And even some of the libraries without any IT-based infrastructure, they can also try many online tools, freely available tools, and provide services to the users. But only a requirement from the librarian's side is to accept the challenge and to make it as a change. For example, I think many people are attending webinars now, and many people are conducting webinars on very good topics like Koha learning or Mendeley or Moodle or any automation softwares like Koha. They can attend the programs and start automating their libraries remotely or if possible in their libraries, or to provide some kind of services by using the many online tools. Thank you.
So actually, can you explain a little more about, because in the absence of these technology resources or with limited resources, how your librarians in self-financing colleges or in government arts colleges could provide service? Very briefly, take only 1 minute.
Sir, I think now the only opportunity for librarians, particularly from government colleges or public libraries, they can use the online freely available tools to provide services, whether it may be a training program or to upgrade their knowledge in particular required domains of library science, or to work for the library. For example, if they have the book data, they can update the data as per the requirement in the software. But I think many people like Suri Narayanan talk about the public library services, mobile library services. But people from government and libraries with less infrastructure, they can use the online freely available tools to provide library services at this moment.
Yes, thank you. See, actually, one more thing I would like to mention here, the networking of institution, networking of people is very essential. See, because if you have a network of people, for example, SARIS, many other associations are there, make use of this association to get resources, you know, from the librarians working in well-established colleges, and then get the paper or something and pass on to the users, as we have been doing also. See, we have a very strong network. That's very, very important. Network of institution, networking of people, and cooperation, coordination. We have been talking about interlibrary loan, resource sharing. So the resource sharing, you know, institution with limited resources, they can approach the institution with more resources, some resource request, no, request some resource article or books or something like that. They can pass on to the need users of their respected college. Thank you very much, Dr. Mandalachalam, for your excellent answer. So now we move on to the another speaker from Dr. Dominic, the expectation of library users. Sir, please take these two questions. Only the user expectation from libraries. For example, in this pandemic, actually, you are also working in a very famous university. Students, you know, the research scholars will be there, students will be there, doctoral students, many are there. So what are the expectations from libraries at this hour of crisis? And how to satisfy the users? Maybe you can couple these two questions and give your answer. Dr. Dominic, sir, please. Dr. Dominic, sir, please kindly unmute your mic. Sir, are you there? Mandarachalam, kindly see that Dr. Dominic is available. Dr. Mandarachalam, please kindly see whether Dr. Dominic is available.
Just a minute, sir. I will check.
Otherwise, we'll call the next speaker so that we can. So now, okay, let us wait for Dr. Dominic. Now I will ask the question from Dr. Swaminathan, speaker, and he spoke very clearly about the importance of what you call librarians, you know, should be very patient with this time and other thing. And he spoke very nice about career and employment, present and the future, the challenges that have been taking place, and what librarians should have, and the skills and other things. So, Dr. Swami, we have four questions to ask you, actually. Maybe kindly, briefly, we expect the answer from you. What are the essential qualities and skills are required for a life professional at the entry level and at career level development? Of course, you have spoke about, you have covered many of these answers to this question. But even then, we wanted to, for the benefit of the audience, can you explain briefly what are the essential qualities?
Yes, sir. First of all, you know, I know Dr. Ila is rightly pointed out this situation. We don't get it. Panic. All of us, even entry level or middle level or senior level, we have a skill to convert these issues or problems into challenge. So you know that issues and focus. Again, I want to focus only four important skills, it all cover under the life skill. Maintaining of your good mental and physical health, saving skills, especially it requires this situation. As Ila Dr. Correctly pointed out, we have to shortcut our expenses. And we should have an open mind to accept the change.
Okay, sir. I'm available now.
I hope that the life skills, you know, will really help us to
manage.
Life skills helps to overcome the financial, physical, and mental health issues. So these are the, as far as concerned, skills. Yeah, regarding how to develop the skills, that is, you know, we have to utilize, now we have a lot of time, sufficient time. So willingness to learn and relearn, and we should be very clear for learning skill. It should be very goal oriented. Many of us, you know, we are coming across a lot of webinars. Everybody, we are applying, whether it is required or not, just we are applying and wasting our time. So we, my sincere request to all the delegates, please, you should be very confident whether it is helpful to us to develop my skill or not. So for the learning purpose, it should be very goal oriented. And we have to utilize the ICT technology properly for learning and relearning. As far as challenge is concerned, once again, I tell you that try to understand likeness and dislikes of likes and dislikes of your employer. We have to play a proactive role. These are the important challenges. We have to prove that we are worth our asset to the institution. And we have to overcome the financial issues. We should know how to overcome the financial issues. I hope I can answer all four questions. In future, if any questions from the participants, I'm ready to take. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Sir, Hariharan, sir.
Sir, Dr. Madhurachalam, sir, in case I think Hariharan, sir, is not available, it seems.
Thank you, Dr. Swaminathan, for
Thank you, sir. Sorry, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Hariharan, sir.
For answering all the four questions very briefly and very clearly. I'm sure that all of our participants might have been invited. And now, Dr. Suryanarayan, sir, there are two questions. You take only very little time, maybe 1 or 2 minutes. And we expect only very brief answer because you have already explained in detail about the actions that have been taken place across the world, starting from USA, UK, and all of the countries. So the first question, how should public libraries serve the community in the present scenario? And then second question also, you can couple with your answer, how public libraries prepare themselves, technology resources service, to serve the community at their doorstep. Of course, you have elaborately explained in your speech in the beginning, but now you can refresh, no, that you can give a brief answer.
And they can serve as the agency for collecting the donations and give it to the government for the corona scenario. And regarding the next question, how public libraries prepare themselves, technology, resource, and services? As I have already told you that by adopting certain cleanliness and safeguard measures, the public libraries can do the traditional library services. Suppose if it is not possible, they can use the e-resources and the internet platform. They can develop the internet technology in the library itself, or the district central library should act as the nodal point, and all the branch libraries shall serve as the agencies collecting the queries and forwarding to the district central library and get the answer, transmitting to the users. And even the mobile services, as I already told you that the each and every district central library, they have the mobile library unit. And instead of community places and to serve as the e-library and e-resources to the needy people, they can highly use that internet technology and even the mobile technology. Thank you.
Your answer to the both these questions. Of course, even nowadays, in as you said, in across the country, even libraries provide, no, provide a shelter to the people, the homeless people. They provide even food also, provide toilet also, and then they also lend, you know, laptop and then mobile and iPad and other thing. Of course, those community places where we can lend books and other things, so that the psychology of will go away. We may we ask our earlier speaker about the we need not be panic and only be very cautious. Thank you, sir. So sure. Now I request Dr. Maureeswaran to clearly explain. Of course, you also explained in a nutshell. Kindly answer these two questions. What is CSIR in a brief?
Yes, sir. What is corporate social responsibility? It is nothing but a librarian. We have our own academic responsibility to serve to our institute itself. Apart from our institute service, being a librarian, we can extend our some contribution to the society for development. That is called a social corporate and responsibility. It can be possible through the extension services. We can conduct community development program. Already I mentioned, through the community development program, we can solve the needy people's problem, and we can adopt some village there. We can make some awareness programs like that, and some slum area children, we ask them to sit one place, and some storyteller are available. Especially in Erode, one madam, Ms. Vanita, is a very good storyteller. We can arrange through Zoom app to telling the story to attract the students, and we can make reading habits among the public. These are the way to provide extension service to the society for the development. I think I answer both the questions.
Now, Dr. Dominic, are you there? Dr. Mandrachalam, could you find out, please?
He lost his signal at his residence. So,
heavy rain going on in place.
Yes, and, yes. I think it's a remote area.
Yes, actually, user expectation from library. That is actually, you know, user as a user, they want everything. They need not to worry about. So some users may realize the prevailing situation, but many user younger generation, no, they because they are digital native and techie. People know they want everything. Why not possible something like that? Though this, no, it's not like the natural calamities like, you know, this flood and earthquake and other thing. There is the communication line might have cut and everything. Our physical infrastructure might have been destroyed. But this corona, this problem, they not touched the other part. The physical structure and the communication line intact. So maybe. The users may expect many things. We have enough resources, as you mentioned, Dr. Mandrachalam. We have resources now. We can provide the remote services under the thing. In that way, we can satisfy the users' requirement. Okay. Now, almost all the speakers they have answered the question. These are the question. Actually, we have framed keeping in view of the users in mind, participants in mind. So they might have asked this kind of question. They might have thought about asking this question. That's why we have framed another thing. Now the forum is open to all, and that participants are requested to ask only specific question to a specific speaker, and you should be very brief question, and the speaker also expected to give only brief reply, because there are maybe a number of questions will be there, and if they don't want to ask anything also, no, specifically, you can also put it in the chat box. So because there are 7 speakers are there, they already spoke about the various aspects of the or various topics in detail, and also answered my questions. So apart from that, if you have any clarification, apart from these questions, and you can address, your question should be very specific and to the specific speaker. Thank you, participant, please. Yes, sir.
very if you take too much time, then I will call upon the next participant. Suppose you want to ask any question, keep it ready and immediately you have to ask it. It should be very brief and immediately ask your question. Kindly unmute your mic. If nobody is there, maybe Mercy wanted to ask some question. Madam. Madam Mercy is there? Would you like to ask any question? You wanted to ask some question, huh? But Dr. Mandarajana, can you check the chat box?
Sir, nothing specific in the chat box questions.
To ask any question, kindly this is the time. You can tell your name and the instant where you belong. And it should be very specific. Our speakers are here to their they will be very happy to answer your question.
Hello.
Yes, please.
Sir, I am Dr. Prabhakaran, sir.
Yes, yes, please.
Sir, what are the psychological skill need for the librarian, sir?
You want to ask to the address?
Put away. Address to the Ilavalakkan, sir.
Okay.
Sir, Prabhakaran, when we talk about psychological skill, I think probably if you are asking me as a librarian, what we need is we need the confidence. First thing, you should actually have the self-belief. You have to believe that you can able to do that. That's an important. And another important thing is you have to have a goal. Where I'm standing now, where I want to move. And you have to take steps achieving that. That's an important. You have to have the mindset being a librarian. And other thing is, what are things that I can able to help others? Because helping is very essential. It's a service kind of thing that since it's in a service oriented profession, probably we should not expect anything from other side. Generally, when we give, we expect whether it is a student, whether it's a parent, then I expect, you know, when I do something for my kid, I'm expecting something at the elderly age. But this is the service-oriented organization. Generally, there should not be any expectation. That's a psychological skill you have to have. And you have to believe yourself. That's an important. Very importantly, you should have the mental strength. Because situation will be differ. People will come with a different behavior psychology. And the way they behave today may not be the same tomorrow. So you should be in a position to take all those emotions, park it properly, and then you decide based on these, you know, conversation and other things, you try to help those people. Don't be very defensive. Most of us are very defensive. Those things, I think probably being a librarian, I think probably if you execute these things or develop these skills, I think that will help you. I think most probably these are the psychology skills that we need to take.
Yeah, thank you for your explanation.
He already spoke about it. You should not be very panic. You should be very psychological. Okay, next question, please.
Sir, this is Kalyani here. Hello, sir. This is Kalyani here. I want to ask it again to Ilavalakkan, sir.
Yes, ma'am. Please go ahead.
So can you hear me?
No, it's not audible.
Your voice is clear, madam. Please go ahead.
Sir, actually, I have conducted 3 meetings for our students. But what's the problem is they don't have the mobile phones or laptops. So they well, if I'm just sending the invite and posting it in our groups, so only some just 40 or 50 strength of students I'm receiving for my online meetings. I doesn't know how to reach them. So when they don't have the gadgets to reach, what are the other possible ways, especially for the students from the rural background? So what are the other possible ways to reach them? Is there any alternative ways that I'm confused? So in what way I can reach them?
Is the problem or mobile gadgets is the problem? There are two things. One is the equipment they may not have. Second thing is, if there is no
equipment, girl students, they don't have the equipment.
Yeah, so the technology
is those who have, they
the only alternative is, because don't think that it is happening only in Tamil Nadu. There are students who sits in Northeast, they are also facing the similar problem. They don't have the gadgets. They don't have internet facility also. At least these students will have access to internet. Only thing is, they don't have the equipment to access. But those people doesn't have even the bandwidth internet. So they also try to get it. Now, how do we cope up this issue? How do we go about it? But the simplest way is, you try to actually collaborate with the nearby institution, where, for example, maybe a school or library, public library, or maybe some place where it is, you know, people can allow to go there using the social distancing, because that's an important, people have to follow all the SOP. There is a standard operating procedure every one of us to follow. You cannot violate it. You try to identify there is a nearby place. For example, the student's relative might be having a small shop, or maybe somebody will be having some kind of, you know, infrastructure where you can try to collect other student through your network. People can go in a particular time, particular period, then probably you can able to penetrate those things. They might
S2. These students are misusing it. Please kindly check their, you know, very often. But you know, one way or other way, the students are also escaping. Just we cannot believe that. It's my one of the suggestions, sir. Thank you.
Sir, good evening, sir.
Please.
Hello, I'm Dr. Shiva speaking.
Please.
I'm from President's University, Kolkata. My question is, budget contribution, they have subscribed a lot of things, universities.
First thing is, I don't know where are we are.
University, universities.
Number two, you have a lot of open education trees are available. There are government initiative, for example, if you go to all the information, a lot of information. What you need, its own implication. For example, institution nearby colleges, you can cannot just because there are many issues. So why institutions are not able to actually give those information? Because these are the certain compliances that we have to follow. On other hand, now today accessing information is not an issue because only the producer has to pay, not the user. We have free access most of these. Only thing is we should be in a position to identify where it is available. There are certain crucial information you cannot get it, then you can get it through some interlibrary loan facility kind of things, but you can't expect everything the other institution will give. So try to actually identify those sources and support your people and on your own as much as possible. If you're asking me, I think whatever that you need, 60% to 70% is freely available through authentic sources. But one of the things we need to identify is
I request participants kindly mute your mic. Some of your mics actually is unmuted and voice is coming in the meeting. I would request.
Hello.
Yes, please.
Hello. Hello. Yes, I'm Bharati. I'm Bharati from Nagpur. Sir, are you? So my question is, as we are all facing a funding problem, then how to search for funding for medical institutions especially?
Yeah, you are looking funding for what? You want to get a, for example,
funding for a library point of view, like library books and all such kind of funding are required. If I require, then how I search for the funding agencies?
The two things: are you looking for resources, funding for resources, or funding for some other activities? When we talk about funding, it is generic in nature. For example, funding for your library automation, funding for getting furniture, funding for, you know, enhancing your infrastructure, or funding for books. Which one you are looking for? You have to be a little clear.
Funding for books.
Correct. The funding for the content. For example, when we talk about the funding, you are as being a special library, you and particularly the material which you are looking is very expensive. You cannot easily get it. Particularly when we talk about some of this authentic material, medical materials are not available. Agreed. But how do I do that? There is no need that you have to be worried about it. Now, lot of journals coming with open access within the journal. For example, if you're looking for some of the medical journal itself, out of 10 articles, 6 articles will be freely available. I think most probably you should have that ability to identify within the magazine, within this journal publisher, what are the open access are available. Now, the models are completely changed. It is not necessarily all these commercial people are, you know, asking pay for the articles, because you're looking for specific article, particularly when you are actually doing with the medical science, health sciences, most probably you're looking for specific information. Now, the specific information most probably are available free of cost through the open access, through the commercial publishers. Most of the commercial publishers getting money from different people and from societies, and they also giving free of cost. One. Number two, I think probably you have to form, so I don't know whether you are from the private medical college or the institute of government or aided, I don't know, but wherever you are, what I suggest you is probably you can form a consortium kind of things, because it's very expensive. Probably being a consortium, 5 colleges, 5 universities, you actually make a form of group. You people have to actually negotiate yourself. For example, I need X, I need Y, you need Z. So 3 of you talk to the publisher, or the aggregator, or the service provider. There are 5 institutions. We want to actually purchase individually. You can purchase and you can share among yourself. I think this model, most of the publishers are actually helping us. But only thing is, instead of 5, you pay separately. You pay 1, the next will pay 2nd, 3rd. So 5 people can able to rotate the resources. And 3rd is lot of institutional repositories. They actually provide lot of free information. free medical no results are there, probably you have to explore those things, then you can able to do that. For example, data sets, if you are looking for any images, because these are all things that you will not get. Some of this data, for example, you are looking for the subject data, you will not get it free of cost. So you need to directly interact with the specialist who actually did the research work. You should have expand your network. For example, academia is there, or LinkedIn is there. There are other things are there. So you should actually expand your network, try to find out, directly reach the authors, because the authors can able to help you to provide the preprint version. You will not get the print version, but you can get the preprint version. That is the way you thank have you. To actually probably you can able to get it.
Thank you so much, sir.
Very expansive. Yes, sir. Okay, any other question is there? Otherwise, we will move on to next agenda, please. You should be very specific. And the speaker also take only 1 minute to answer it. Because we are getting, you know, time is moving. If you have any question is there?
Sir, before that, I'll explain about the feedback form. For the past 19 programs, we have provided the attendance participation certificate based on the attendance in the GoToMeeting platform. This time we tried a new thing and asked the participants request through the Google form, and we designed a feedback form, quiz form. Quiz is not a tricky one or very hard to answer. It's based on the program, only very few questions, about 5 questions. Simply you can answer and you will get a participation certificate immediately or there tomorrow. Okay, the quiz come feedback form will be shared before the end of the program. Please wait. Okay, sir, you will move on to the next program. Oh, sir,
thank you, Dr. Thank you, Dr. Mandarachalan. But he has spent more than 2-3 days to design the questionnaire and then the Google form and another thing. But we have got more than 600 response, thankfully, but we have stopped it. So within there is no other question, you all move on to the next agenda. I would request Dr. Pattabhi Raman, a senior librarian from Abdul Rahman Kersan University, to present the report very briefly. Don't take more than 2 minutes. Dr. Pattabhi Raman, are you there?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Hello. Be very brief. Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes, are you hearing, sir?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, sir, good evening. Out of the time, I am the webinar. It is my pleasure to submit the webinar of 20th webinar of our SALIS. Dr. Hariharan, sir, founder president SALIS, gave an introduction about the 20th webinar. And then followed by the Ms. Mercy Madam of Vellalar College for Women, gave a welcome address about the webinar and the resource persons. Followed by Dr. J. Dominic, sir, chief librarian, Karunya University, gave lecture on expectations of library users. Followed by Dr. R. Sevagan, sir, associate professor, DLIS, Pondicherry University, gave a lecture on LIS education and research. Followed by Dr. Mandira Salam, librarian and dean of Parambattam Institute of Technology, gave lecture on technology resources and services are available and how to allies professions serve when technologies and resources are not available. It was very much interesting that lecture. Followed by Dr. S. Swaminathan, librarian, Sri Ramakrishna Mission Vidyalaya, gave lecture about career and employment problems and the future. Career and employment, present and future. Dr. Surya Narayan, sir, former librarian, gave lecture on public library services during this COVID period. Followed by Dr. K. Elavalagan, sir, librarian, IIM Trichy, gave lecture about the skills to cope up with the change types of skills required to serve the users in the prevailing COVID-19 situation and other essential skills required, etc. Finally, Dr. Captain T. Magadisaran, librarian, Chikkanayagar College, Erode, gave a lecture on corporate social responsibility and extension services as what is CSR and what is what kind like that. Finally, all the participants also very much interestedly involved in asking with the resource persons, and it was very much useful for I feel everybody got much knowledge on this webinar. Thanks, thanks for giving me an opportunity to submit the report about this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Pattabhiraman, for briefly reporting the today's proceedings. And really, all these research person, 8-7 research person are they're very senior and much knowledgeable person, and they have covered various aspects of this today's problem and what are the challenges and the solution also they have given. And definitely, all the participants might have got benefited by the attending this webinar. So before that, before I call upon the to formally present what of thanks, see, each and every organization has a responsibility to give some guidelines at this hour of crisis, for us how to deal with this problem. I will take only 2-3 minutes, and these are the some of the ideas which I got it. And later on, you can also send your thinking and thought and a thing. We can combine everything and consolidate all those advices, all those what you call your ideas and other thing, and put it in proper format, and we'll send to all of you. That will be your guideline. Suppose you wanted to open the library. Let me take only few minutes. The first is actually, suppose you are asked to start open your library. What should you do? Follow the local government rules and regulations very strictly. Follow the management, that is your institution's rules, and accordingly you can strictly adhere and follow. And at least you prepare such a way. The phase one importance to your healthy aspect, health aspects of the library staff as well as users. So first you have to, whenever you want to open your library, then the first day open all the doors and windows. Should ventilation should be very clear, sunlight should come inside, and put all the fans, switch off all air conditioner, and clean and disinfect the floor with the chemicals and other things. Door and window should be kept open, and you should clean the staircase, counter, and other thing. That's at least for 5 hours should be kept open. Later on, no, when the users started coming, you allow only few users, that I will tell you now. And you should have a temperature checking mechanism, that instrument you should have. Whenever the user enters, you have to check it. You should have enough face mask, hand gloves, and sanitizers. In phase two, actually, you should have only limited hours working. For example, today morning, 1 or 2 members. That is limited staff with you to operation, actually. Then limited user, you allow only limited user with respect to the space of the library. You measure the square feet of the reading room and then the other, internet room and other thing. Accordingly, you can allow actually. So you can also prior appointment. You can request prior appointment for space or reserve a system for internet browsing and other thing. And you should allow only the contact issue and return. That is the old good old is this close access system. He should not touch anything. And what are the books that did by email or something, you can scan it and other thing, and keep it all the written books separately and quarantine for at least minimum 7 days. And actually you extend all the loan period to unlimited time till the problem is over, and allow all unlimited renewal for the library software. And nowadays the e-lending is available. If you have a tie up with the publishers, you allow the e-lending. If you have multiple access or simultaneous access, you can provide to many users or limited access. Only give five days in a week, and then ask others to allow the others to issue it actually. Limited e-lending and access to collection from your resources, remote access.
and allow the, you can talk to your publisher, allow them no unlimited download actually, otherwise chapter is not possible, and allow the remote access and make a library on the intranet and allow them to provide full text access. And the phase three, depending upon the situation of the government and the government guidelines, you can increase the staff slowly. Number of hours can be extended to 8 to 9 to 10 9 to 12 to 9 to 4, something like that. Or you can rotate the shift and increase the staff number, increase the users with respect to the floor space and number of furniture, of course appointment, these are all the thing actually. So depending upon the situation, no, you can think it up over. Suppose if you have any idea, you can send it to us. All I request all the participants and the honorable speakers here, they can also think it over, and they can you have any valid point, you can pass on to us. We can compile all those things and we can prepare a report and then send to all our members and the professional. So with this one, I thank all the speakers and all the participants for your continuous supports and taking a lot of patiently the speakers, and they have prepared extensively and addressed all the questions that came from the users. And with this, we will pass on to the next agenda. And that is, normally we have to thank our speakers as well as the audience. I now request Dr. Mani from Einstein College, the Tirunelveli. What up?
Audible, sir?
Yes, please.
Good evening to one and all. It is my great pleasure to deliver a vote of thanks in this end of the session. During the COVID-19 lockdown period, we have successfully conducted 20th webinar at series. First, I would like to thank to our founder president, Dr. A. Hariharan sir, and our advisors, the present president, Dr. K. Ilavalagan sir, vice president and senior president, Dr. A. M. Venkatachalam sir, general secretary, Dr. A. Karunai Raghavan sir, and joint secretaries, all the EC member. Addition to that, Sally's chapter's family members. Special thanks to today's webinar series, FAQ and dynamic speakers, and seven pillars of our webinar session. Dr. K. Ilavalagan sir, librarian from IIM Tiruchi. Dr. R. Sevagan sir, associate professor from Pondicherry University. Dr. M. Mandrachalam sir, librarian and dean, Coimbatore Institute of Technology. Dr. J. Bhumik sir, chief librarian from Karunia University. Dr. S. Swaminathan sir, librarian, Sri Ramakrishna Mission Vidyalaya College of Education. Dr. S. Suryanarayanan sir, former librarian, Sri Paramakalyani College, Alwar Kuruchi. Dr. Captain T. Magudishwaran, librarian from my college, Erode. And the moderator of the session, Evergreen founder, President Dr. A. Hariharan sir. All the speaker delivered the lecture was very informative and important one of the current scenario. We hope this, the lecture was very useful to the participants. Finally, I express my sincere thanks to all the energetic participants for attending from various states and countries. Wish you all the support. Coming soon, we will meet on the next webinar series. Once again, thank you to all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Mani, for the vote of thanks. Dear participants, we will make all the recordings. We will send the link to all the registered participants. You need not worry about it. Whenever you get time, then you can listen to the speakers. And with this, I once again thank all the speakers and all the audience, all the participants for your continuous support for the last 20 webinars. So with this, we'll conclude the today's conclave, the webinar. Thank you, one and all.
Sir, I request all of you to submit your feedback and
thank you.
Quiz form. And already around 35 people were submitted the feedback on quiz, and automatically certificate will be sent to your email within 5 minutes. I think already 35 people were generated the e-certificate. Thank you. Please submit before 9:30 PM today. Thank you one and all for your patient listening and participation. Sir, Hariharan sir, are you there?